Television 9, your Eyewitness News Station.
Because of the following special broadcast, Fat Albert will not be presented today. It'll return next week at its regular time on most of these stations. I'm Dan Rather, one of the White House correspondents for CBS News. We've just seen some of the men who have been President of the United States. The person who holds that job is the most powerful elected official in the world. In fact, in the news these days, you might hear some people saying the job has become too powerful. Well, in this half hour, we're going to find out exactly what the President's powers are, where they come from, and how he is allowed to use them. From George Washington to Richard Nixon, it's been quite a story. From CBS News, What's the Presidency All About? A special broadcast for young people with CBS News White House correspondent Dan Rather. Sponsored by Post Cereals, the cereals that make breakfast a little bit better.
Can't get enough soup, sugar, crisp.
Hi, Sugar Bear.
Hi, kid.
Sugar Bear, watch out for the blob.
Don't worry about the blob. Just have a good breakfast featuring Super Sugar Crisp.
A fly high balloon and Super Sugar Crisp.
Put it together. Blow it up.
Punch! Look at her go!
Wow, look at that golly!
Jeez, my punch!
It's an especially dark box of Super Sugar Crisp.
Well, we're all out of orange-flavored Tang.
Golly, the grape flavor's gone, too.
Listen, why don't I go to the Earth and get some more?
Yeah?
I could trade them some rocks.
Rocks? For an instant breakfast drink with more vitamin C than orange juice?
Sure. I'll be right back.
What is vitamin C anyway?
Well, I'm back.
He got both orange and grape-flavored Tang.
For a bag of rocks.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes I wonder if there's intelligent life on that planet.
This is the seal of the President of the United States. It's the symbol of the great power and prestige of the presidency. Take a good look at it, because when it shows up next, you'll see it on the floor of a well-known room in Washington, D.C. A copy of the seal is woven into the rug in the famous White House Oval Office, which many of our presidents have used. Right now, this is Richard Nixon's office. Every president chooses his own desk and chair. President Nixon's desk was the one he used when he was vice president. President Nixon keeps the top of his desk clear, but President Franklin Roosevelt liked to keep the top of his desk cluttered with all kinds of souvenirs he loved. President Truman used to keep a sign on his desk saying, "The buck stops here." That meant he was the last one to get all the problems and the only one who could make the decisions to solve them. President Kennedy, who loved sailing, used a desk he found in the White House broadcasting room. It was made from the wood of the British ship HMS Resolute. His son John John liked to play in it. On President Nixon's desk is the telephone with which he can call his assistants or almost any leader in the world. In the back of the Oval Office is where the president can sit and talk with his guests. Those guests are leaders from all over the world, from Germany, from Spain, or Cambodia. A year ago, I was President Nixon's guest. We sat here and talked about the election, China, and women's lib, while the nation watched on television. By now, you can see why this is called the Oval Office. That's its shape, just like an egg. President Nixon does some of his work here, but he does a great deal of his work across the street in another smaller office in the Executive Office Building. You might say he feels more at ease over there. Actually, the president's office is wherever he is at the moment. Sometimes it's 30,000 feet in the air, moving at 600 miles an hour on Air Force One. Well, how do you get to sit behind this desk? And if and when you got here,
What do you do? Is there a book of instructions in one of these drawers which tells you how to be president? It isn't that easy. The only instructions this country has about the presidency takes only a few paragraphs in our Constitution. According to the Constitution, the qualifications you need to sit in this chair are that you be 35 or over, that you were born a United States citizen, and that you've lived in this country for the last 14 years. Millions of Americans fit those qualifications. But to be president, you also have to win an election. It's only once every 4 years that a new president takes the oath spelled out in the Constitution.
Hi, hi, yes, Truman.
Hi, John Fitzgerald Kennedy.
Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
Hi, Lyndon Baines Johnson.
I, Richard Billhouse Nixon, do solemnly swear
that I will faithfully execute the office
of President of the United States
and will, to the best of my ability,
preserve, protect, and defend
the Constitution of the United States.
So help me God.
4 years is the term of the president's office, and he can only be elected 2 times. These days, the job pays $200,000 a year in salary, $50,000 for expenses, and $40,000 for travel. Room and board are free. Back when presidents were paid less, ex-farmer Calvin Coolidge stretched the family budget by raising chickens in the White House yard. George Washington got $25,000 a year, but there were no income taxes back when he was president. Even so, he had to borrow money to go to his own inauguration. Even though our country was much smaller in those days, George Washington found the job of being president very difficult because no one had ever been president of the United States before. He knew that everything he did would help set the model for all the presidents to follow him. Starting with George Washington, 36 different men had now been president of the United States. By the way, Richard Nixon is called the 37th president. You might wonder how we could have a 37th president if only 36 men have served. But that's because Grover Cleveland served a term, then went out of office during Benjamin Harrison's administration, and then came back to serve again. So we've actually had 36 men in 37 different administrations. From Washington to Nixon, every man who has held the presidential office has added something else to the responsibilities. Today, the man who is president has to work at least 8 different jobs. Now, as we see what those 8 jobs are, it will become clear why the presidency is so powerful. First of all, the person who sits behind this desk is the chief of quite a few things. For example, he's chief of state. To be chief of state means the president is the ceremonial head of the country. In this particular job, he is to us what a king or queen is to England or what an emperor is to Japan. He is the living symbol of the people and the power that is the United States. As chief of state, the president has many ceremonial duties to perform. For example, he gives out medals to war heroes. He greets the winners of contests. He's greeted men coming back from the moon. Sometimes he throws out the first ball at the beginning of the baseball season. He stands at the front door of the White House to greet the chiefs of state from other countries. Inside, he entertains them at elaborate state dinners. He also travels to other countries on official visits. President Nixon's trip to China last year was a good example of the role a president plays as chief of state. President William Howard Taft once said, "The president represents the dignity and the majesty of the American people. At more than 300 pounds, you might say no one was more majestic than President Taft." The president is not only chief of state, he's another kind of chief too. He's chief executive of the United States. In this job, it's his responsibility to see to it the laws Congress passes are enforced. He also enforces the decisions of the federal courts and carries out the treaties we make with foreign countries. Of course, he doesn't do all this by himself. He has departments like the Justice Department with its Federal Bureau of Investigation to help him. The president nominates the heads of the different departments of government, such as the State Department and the Labor Department. The heads of all the departments form what is called the president's cabinet. As chief executive, the president determines what policies each department of government works under. The president also nominates the justices of the Supreme Court, but all these nominations have to be approved by a majority of the Senate, which questions each of his choices at special hearings. As chief executive, the president can grant pardons to federal prisoners. In his first term, President Nixon released former Union President James Hoffa from federal prison. As chief executive, the president can also act in an emergency, using certain laws to stop strikes or other laws to send relief to disaster areas. So, to sum up, as chief executive, the president has all the departments of government except the Congress and the Supreme Court reporting to him. Now, being chief executive alone would make him a very powerful man. But he's also another very important chief. He is commander-in-chief of all the nation's armed forces. All the generals of the Army and all the admirals of the Navy take their orders from him. And if a president doesn't like what a general does, he can relieve him of command. President Truman fired General Douglas MacArthur during the Korean War because the general wanted to conduct the war his own way. As commander-in-chief, the president can send troops anywhere in the world to protect American lives or to answer calls for help. But the president can't declare war by himself. It takes an act of Congress to send the nation into war with all its wartime laws. That's why President Roosevelt went before Congress in 1941 to ask them to declare war on the Japanese, who had just attacked our naval base at Pearl Harbor.
I ask that the Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
For the last 12 years, American presidents conducted war in Southeast Asia without a declaration of war by Congress. Because our involvement in Vietnam became very large, there are many congressmen in favor of new laws that would limit a president's authority to use American military power overseas without very clear instructions from Congress. Not only does the president command the armed forces, but he is also in charge of the most awesome weapons in the world. Only the president can order the use of our nuclear weapons. So the first three jobs of being president involve being a chief. Chief of state, chief executive, and commander in chief. Now let's move into another one of the president's great responsibilities. The president directs American foreign policy. Foreign policy is how we deal with other nations. For example, the fact that we do not recognize the communist government of Cuba headed by Fidel Castro is part of our foreign policy. It's foreign policy when we give fighter planes to Israel or Greece. It's part of our foreign policy to sell huge amounts of grain to the Soviet Union. Foreign policy can change. When President Nixon went to China, he went there not only as chief of state, but he went there to begin a new foreign policy with a country we had regarded as an enemy. Many of our presidents relied on their secretaries of state to help make foreign policy. President Eisenhower was influenced by his secretary of state, John Foster Dulles. But many presidents, including Richard Nixon, have liked to direct most of the policy themselves. To help him do this, President Nixon relies heavily on his personal advisor, Henry Kissinger. Although the president can make treaties with other nations and appoint ambassadors to countries around the world, he still needs the approval of the Senate to do these things. When the president makes a foreign policy decision affecting the people of the United States, it also affects millions of people living elsewhere. As a result, to the people of the world, the president is the best-known American and the man who speaks for the power of the United States. While most people throughout the world can name our president, how many Americans do you think could name the president of Mexico or Uganda or the prime minister of Canada? Did you recognize President Echeverria of Mexico, President Amin of Uganda, and Prime Minister Trudeau of Canada? In a moment, why we have a president and not a king? When we continue with What's the Presidency All About?
Give me a U, give me a P, get the alphabet easy. I got an A, look at my B, gonna eat my alphabet to S-Y-B. Bitch, I can make you say yes.
I know you can.
What's that spell?
Why, yes, yes.
You said it.
Vitamin
C's and KTT's, gonna have a good breakfast with my ABC's. Grab your alphabet and
Wilma, watch. My new invention sends me my Flintstone cereals without leaving the chair.
Hey, Fruity and Cocoa Pebbles.
Fantastic.
Now I'll have some.
Wilma, Fred's a genius.
Ooh, Fruity Pebbles tastes like a bowl of noisy fruit, and Cocoa Pebbles are Cocoa Moco good.
Empty?
Hey, Fred, your pebbles are delicious.
Bonnie, why you?
Oh, I love pebbles. Yabba dabba do.
Where's my post-raisin bran?
I've got the post-raisin bran. Cuz, I just wanted to tell you, this cereal's got a lot of delicious raisins. And I get fun stickers, too. Just peel them off, and you can stick them on almost anything. There's 3 cents in all. And you get 1 cent free in every specially marked box of Pulse Raisin Bran. Hey, Dad, how about the Pulse Raisin Bran?
Can't get enough soup sugar, Crisp.
Hi, Sugar Bear.
Hi, kid.
Sugar Bear, watch out for the blob.
Don't worry about the blob. Just have a good breakfast featuring Super Sugar Crisp.
A fly high balloon and Super Sugar Crisp.
Put it together. Blow it up.
Blast!
Look at it go!
Wow, look at that, darling!
It's an each specially marked box of Super Sugar Crisp.
Here again is Dan Rather.
We're so used to the idea of having a president that it seems we've always had one. But as a matter of fact, this country had been in existence about 13 years before George Washington went to New York to take the first oath of office. Here's how the American presidency came about.
After the American Revolution, the 13 original states governed themselves under what was called the Articles of Confederation. They had no Congress which could collect taxes, they had no way of raising an army, and there was no way of enforcing laws. There was also no strong central leader of the country. In order to make the Articles of Confederation stronger, the states sent 55 delegates to Philadelphia in the spring of 1787. Among them were Ben Franklin of Pennsylvania, Alexander Hamilton of New York, and James Madison of Virginia. In charge of those secret meetings was George Washington. 4 months later, when the delegates finished their work, instead of a stronger Articles of Confederation, we had a new constitution and a new kind of government. During that hot Philadelphia summer, a good many delegates said the United States should have a king, but they were reminded that it was an English king, King George III, who had brought about the American Revolution. As a result, there were suggestions that two or three men head the government, so one man would not become all powerful. Some delegates wanted a president who would serve for life, while others thought 20 years or even 7 years was long enough. Out of all the arguments came a compromise based on an idea of James Wilson of Pennsylvania. We would have a single president. He would serve for a term of 4 years, and his title would be His Excellency. By the way, after George Washington was chosen as our first president, his vice president, John Adams, thought our new leader should be called His Highness, the President of the United States and Protector of the Rights of Same. However, George Washington said simply being called president was good enough for him.
At first, the Constitution did not put a limit on the number of terms a president could serve. Since Washington decided to serve only 2 terms, so did every other president who followed, with the exception of Franklin Roosevelt, who was elected to 4 terms. As a result of Roosevelt's many elections, the Constitution was amended. It now limits any president to only 2 elected terms, the number of terms George Washington chose to have.
Even though we think of our president as being leader of all the people, it wasn't all the people who selected him to run the office. The men who run for president belonged to political parties. It was these political parties, such as the Democrats or the Republicans, which nominated them and paid for their campaign expenses. When a party gets their man elected president, they consider him to be the leader of the party, too. President Nixon is a Republican, and being president makes him the most powerful Republican in his party. He has the power to select the party officials, and he can give out thousands of jobs in government to those who worked hard for the party and his election. Many times, big campaign contributors get to be ambassadors to countries like France. Because he controls his party, a president can usually get a second term nomination if he wants it.
Not only is the president the leader of his political party, but he's the nation's popular leader, too. He can get the nation's attention anytime he wants to. something no other elected official can do.
Hundreds of reporters are assigned to cover the president wherever he goes. President Johnson used to hold press conferences as he raced around the White House grounds. Many times, President Truman would talk to the press on his fast early morning walks he liked to take. President Franklin Roosevelt used to talk to the nation from the White House in his famous fireside chats.
It needs no prophet to tell you that when the people find that they can get their money, that they can get it when they want it for all legitimate purposes, the phantom of fear will soon be laid.
With a slight change of scenery, the Oval Office becomes a studio. President Nixon was able to sit behind his desk in January and tell the nation about the ceasefire in Vietnam.
To end the war and bring peace with honor in Vietnam and in Southeast Asia.
Presidents can hold news conferences anytime they wish. President Kennedy was noted for the humor he used to get into his many televised conferences.
I wonder if you could tell us whether, if you had it to do over again, you would work for the presidency and whether you can recommend the job to others.
Well, the answer is, the first is yes, and the second is no. I don't recommend it to others. At least for a while.
Everything a president does is reported throughout the world. Who did he see today? Where does he go to church? What does he like to eat? The popular appeal of a president extends to his family as well. When President Nixon's daughter, Tricia, was married at the White House, it became a nationally televised event, not a quiet family wedding. White House families are famous forever. The press still reports the appearances of Mrs. Mamie Eisenhower, the wife of President Eisenhower, and Mrs. Jacqueline Onassis, who had been married to President Kennedy.
So the president, as our popular leader, gets power from the people because the people are truly interested in everything he and his family do. A president has no trouble getting his views heard by the American people. Now, here's another one of the president's many jobs.
The Constitution requires that the president tell Congress about the State of the Union each year. This was President Eisenhower in 1955.
The transition to a peacetime economy is largely behind us. The economic outlook is good.
In the message, the president usually calls on the Congress to pass certain laws called legislation. He asks for laws to create programs such as going into space, finding a cure for cancer, or cleaning up our polluted waterways. The president cannot force Congress to pass the laws he wants, but he can bring a lot of pressure to bear. One way is to use his popular appeal to take his case over the heads of Congress directly to the people. He tries to get the people to pressure Congress. Another way a president can bring pressure on Congress is to veto Congress's favorite programs if they don't pass his favorite programs. To veto a program means to vote no. It means the program is dead unless the Congress can get two-thirds of its members to vote yes on the program once again. That seldom happens. So things have to get done by compromise. To compromise means each side must give a little.
To do his job, the president requires a lot of help. He needs assistants, advisors, counselors, secretaries, and thousands of other special people to help provide him with the information he needs to make decisions. They all make up what is known as the executive office, which the president, in one of his other jobs, heads. So far, we've seen that the president has great power. You might begin to wonder what's to stop him from doing almost anything he wants. How far can he go towards one-man rule?
The writers of the Constitution thought of this, and they built safety valves into their document. A safety valve pops and lets out the pressure when things got to a dangerous level. The safety valves in the Constitution, which protect us from the presidency getting too powerful, are what is known as checks and balances. A check means to stop something. A balance means a way of evening things up. For example, if a president vetoes or kills a program that Congress really wants, we said they can vote on it again and make the program law in spite of the president's veto. The veto is a check. Overriding the veto is a balance. If the president appoints someone to his cabinet or to some other important job, the Senate must approve the person before he takes his office. That's a balance. Although the president is the one to make up the budget, how we spend our money, Congress is the one to give him the money. This is a balance. Another check hanging over the president is the possibility of impeachment. Impeachment means that if the president fails to perform in office, if he does not live up to the Constitution, he can be removed by a two-thirds vote of the House and Senate, and after a Senate trial. No American president has ever been removed from office, although impeachment was tried against President Andrew Johnson in 1868. Finally, if a president fails to please the people, they themselves can remove him from office through elections at the end of his term. So presidential power is checked here and balanced there, so that theoretically no one part of our government gets to be any stronger than any other part. When the balance leans one way, as many are now saying the presidency is too strong, there are means by which the congressional branch of government can tilt things over the other way.
If the Congress and the president get to a point where there's a serious dispute on who has the authority to act, then the final judge becomes the third branch of the government, the Supreme Court. As we have seen today, the job of being president has eight important parts. From time to time, it's been suggested that we have two presidents, one to run the country and the other just to attend ceremonies. So, as we've tried to show, the presidency is a job with a great deal of power. Power to send men into combat, power to deal with other nations, power to persuade the people in the Congress that a certain course should be followed. These days, there are many, especially in Congress, who feel that the presidency has become too powerful. They talk of a constitutional crisis. They say that the executive branch of government, led by the president, has become more powerful than the Constitution intended. Struggles between the president and the Congress are not new. They go all the way back to George Washington's time. But the power of the presidency has grown so that this current fight for authority might indeed put the Constitution to a test. Its outcome, decided perhaps in the Supreme Court, might change American history for years to come. That's why we took the time today for this brief look at what the presidency is all about. I'm Dan Rather for CBS News.
It's a Kool-Aid day, gonna have a good day. Reach for the sky, run in the sun. Fun day, Kool-Aid takes the heat off, puts the flavor on, makes your day a Kool-Aid, Kool-Aid. It's a Kool-Aid day, gonna make it today.
Make Kool-Aid brand soft drink mix. Make your day.
What's the Presidency All About? Has been sponsored by Kool-Aid brand regular and sugar-sweetened soft drink mix.
White House, a very pleasant place to live, but it's just like living behind an iron fence or behind bars, really. I used to call it the Great White Jail.
It is truly, I think, the most powerful position in the free world.
One of a president's greatest resources is the moral authority of his office.
A president's hardest task is not to do what is right, but to know what is right.